the sacrifices of joy. I will sing yay. I will sing praises to the Lord. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Isn't that beautiful? When we come together, we're to enter in with praise and with thanksgiving, and we are to sing songs, new songs that God gives to us in our hearts unto the Lord. The Bible says that that's the way we should come in to the house of God.
Hallelujah. Amen.
I know in the Old Testament, when they come before the temple, they would come marching in, and they'd be chanting and singing and praising the goodness of the Lord for all that He had done and was doing for them. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. I want everyone to turn around, shake hands with somebody, and say it's good to be in the house of the Lord.
After his surgery, he would come back to work and do office.
Oh, yeah,
I thought she was going to talk about how he's home now to watch the kids. God is good, isn't he? James, you shared that with me a few days ago, and I was weeping in my spirit how God provides and takes care of his own. He's so grateful in every way. God is so grateful. Remember, next week is Potluck Sunday, it's Friends Sunday. How many will invite somebody or bring somebody to come to church next week? And we have a big potluck dinner afterwards, and it'll be my last Sunday, and I'll be with my mom, and she's going to be going back next week to Ohio. So we wanted to have a good time of fellowship after service, and so we're looking forward to that. So please, come bring your potluck with you, and we'll just have a great time out there. Amen. Sheila.
27, 28, 29, change it.
Hey,
David made that.
Yes, we do have Uncle Don coming. We
have Thursday, all four. Sure.
The Brother Don, Uncle Don is going to be ministering to us. How old is Don? 81. That's Brother Philip's brother.
I got
and so this goes back years and years and years ago. And this is an opportunity for me here. And finally, some weeks ago, I forgot that it was this Sunday coming, that we'll be ministering and to us and sharing. And I love to hear from the old timers. And they have some remembers. I remember Brother Phillips was sharing with me. He remembers as a small boy, his dad loading all the kids in a wagon. And off they'd go to church and they'd all be singing. And I know the Lord. His dad would sing that song, I know the Lord will make a way for me. I know the Lord will make a way for me. And I thought, wow, that's going back some years and years and years ago. And certainly God has made a way for some of these old timers. We're going to look forward to having him here next week with us. Praise the Lord. God is good, isn't he? Also, Sheila, is that an announcement to make concerning sisterhood?
Good morning, ladies.
Good morning.
I have been missing you in Bible study. But I'm hoping you'll all come on the 5th of May. We're going to have, it's the last, like our Bible study's wrapping up. So we're going to have a salad luncheon that day. There is a sign up in the foyer on one of the round tables. Or you can see me or text me if you think of something during the week. I'll make sure you get added to the list. I would love to see every one of your beautiful smiling faces there. Also... Also, Sister Crystal has decided we're going to start doing some cards and things for those that are in need and those that need a little encouragement situations that are coming up. So we started this week for Michelle. Yeah, well, Kim's name totally just went out of my head. Kim Spanhook's friend Michelle. So I'm going to pass that around this morning and you can sign it and we will get that to them this week, okay? All right, thank you.
There will be life groups tonight, so please be here at 6 o'clock and we'd love to have you with us. It'll be a great time. God is good. Praise the Lord. We have many that are sick and going through some afflictions and maybe having a time of prayer just a little bit. I want to give you a worship of God and let the Spirit of the Lord just have his way. Be obedient. Someone said to me just before a service this morning that
he wants to speak.
I just wanted to say a piece about Michelle's situation.
Okay, I'm sorry.
It's gotten worse. They had to do some draining and some surgery on her brain in order to alleviate the swelling. And she's been non-responsive for 3 days. And it's coming within a day or two that decisions will need to be made. That, you know, they're going to, I guess, on Monday, attempt to take the ventilation off of her to see. But it's to the point that the family's likely to have to make decisions on if she'll be sustained on 24/7 life support terminally and never, you know what I mean, be the Michelle that everybody's known. if they don't get some more response out of her in the next day or two. So it's gone from bad to a lot worse for the whole family, so.
Let's just pray right now. Like that, but God. Everybody say, but God.
But God.
We know with God all things are possible. And let's just pray for that family right now. Lord Jesus, I thank you that we can look to you, Lord, in the darkest moments, in the moments when there's no hope, moments, Lord, when there seems to be no answer, those moments when it seems that our faith is failing and we don't know what to do, Lord. God, we look to you. We look to you because you know the weaknesses, Lord, of our faith, and you know the weaknesses, Lord, of our abilities to comprehend all these things. We know that, God, when we are weak, then are you strong. We bring Michelle to you right now, Lord. You see what that family's going through, and you see the need in her life for a miracle. God, we know you're the worker of miracles, and that, Lord, you can quicken that mind, and you can, Lord, bring the fibers back together again, and Lord, you can begin to join it, and Lord, bring to her back her mind and memory, Lord, just like that in an instant, in a moment, Lord. So, God, we pray there would be a response, there would be a quickening right now in her body, and then, Lord, for your glory and for your praise, you would bring a healing to Michelle. And then, Lord, would just be something so miraculous that entire family would begin to praise you, look to you, and magnify you, Lord. Give their lives to you. Follow you with all their hearts. God, we just ask you, Lord, to work that miracle these next hours in her life. And we'll praise you for it, Lord. God, I pray that you would be on our hearts constantly, and that, Lord, we would just give you, Lord, all the praise for what you do. We'll thank you for it. We'll thank you for it. In Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Keep praying. Keep believing.
Yes.
With God, all things are possible.
Offer.
Okay, offer. Yes. Hallelujah. Come on up, and we want to give. I tell you what, I get so carried away with all these things, and my heart gets burdened, and you want to do it. But I did want to say, too, that we're sending $3,000 to Sierra Leone on Monday.
Very good.
And the church one, I got several more pictures of buildings that are going up just this week. A new church has been dedicated. My wife's going to do a collage of pictures out on the mission board for next week. To see what's going on over there. Almost every week I'm getting pictures, and the progress there is just, it's electrifying, it's amazing. And my phone went off yesterday morning about 3 o'clock in the morning. It went beep, 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 with 7 pictures from Sierra Leone, and I knew what it was when it was coming in that early in the morning. We're just still a little deaf. And I wanted you to know that money's going over there and is helping them in a lot of ways, and they're so grateful. Dan wrote me and said, thank you, thank you, thank you. I haven't gotten yet, but thank you, thank you, thank you. And we appreciate that. So your giving and everything goes not just for Bethel, but for the regions beyond, for the glory of God. Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. Give as God has given you an opportunity to give. So our brother Ron, would you ask God's blessing?
Away. It was time. You call lift up your eyes to the one who was, to the one who is, and is to God.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
raise your hand and sing. Raise your hand in total abandonment to Him. Not thinking about anything else around you, not thinking about the troubles and the situations that you have. But know that praise is your weapon. That we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. But that God reigns and rules over all. And we, as His children, can come before Him and praise. And when we praise, peace comes. When we praise, you don't know where to go. Jesus is who you need.
here, just, you know, someone came to my office, Kim, really beat down. She said she just wished she could be in the worship service this morning. Mother fell and broke 3 ribs, and she's been struggling taking care of her, and her condition's getting worse. She's 85 years old, and Kim, I told Kim we would pray for her this morning. I felt this would be an opportune time for the ladies. If you ladies would get together, just pray for Kim and her mother, Joanne, that God would touch and bring healing to her body. I know that Kim was under a lot of anxiety this morning in my office, and we need to pray one for another. Amen. You don't know until you're going through that situation, the stress you can be under, and I feel that I needed to. She's over there working with the children right now. I think it's so important, though, that she knows that we're praying for her and for that situation there. So, the ladies, if you could just gather together. If there's others here this morning, you need special prayer. No kiddies here. We're going through a lot of anxiety. Girls, boys, the young people have so many traumatic things they go through every day. If you're here and you're needing prayer, or you want to come and pray with Kenny, let's just spend a little bit of time here. Just reach out and pray for one another.
God alone to you.
ourselves. One moment in His presence can change and turn a situation around. God can either convict us or sometimes convert us, transform us in just a moment, a heartbeat, in the very presence of God. And I thank the Lord for that. And just being able to dwell in His presence and to feel God in our midst is a wonderful thing. I know some people look at you and says, crazy sometimes. Hey, you're the one in need, and the Holy Ghost comes down. I'll never forget. I was reading it this week, my reading through the Bible, where Michael, David's wife, mocked him when he ran before the ark of the Lord, and he danced before the people, and he was just in his linen clothes. He didn't have his robes of royalty on. He was just with the common people, and they were rejoicing because after 20 years, they're bringing the ark back to Jerusalem. And Michael stood up and criticized and condemned him. And because of that, God struck her with barrenness. She never had a child. And David's love for her was dissipated because he saw in her a spirit of her daddy, the spirit of Saul, a religious spirit. A pomp and self-righteousness that put themselves above the people, where David put himself right down with the people.
Hallelujah.
And where is God? Where is God? God is with us.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
I want to be where God is. Amen. With the people. Amen?
Yes.
With the people.
Yes.
And I appreciate the presence of the Lord. And I get excited when others get touched. And God looks at right now. I want to tell other people up to pray and waiting on the Lord. And it's good for you too. If the Lord leads you, come and pray with them. Don't feel inhibited to come out and lay your hand. Maybe you're the very one God wants to work through. Maybe you're there and you're just afraid to step out and come. Hey, come on out. Get a hold of God. Maybe God will do for you what you need to have done for you. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
And, we're a Pentecostal church. We love God. We're going to get into the Holy Spirit and the move of God as we're talking about after Easter in this series. And we're going to be laying a foundation for that which God did in the book of Acts. And it's called the Acts of the Holy Ghost, the Acts of the Holy Spirit. And we're going to see that after Easter, great and mighty things began to happen. And through what God was going to call His church.
Amen.
We're going to see the foundation of that being laid by Jesus in His final day on the earth before He was going to be ascended on high. If you turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 1, it is a continuation of Luke chapter 24, where they're gathering, and He's telling them to go to Jerusalem and tarry until they be endued on high with power. And in Acts chapter 1, it's the same guy writing. His name is Luke. He wrote the book of Luke, and he's now writing the book of Acts to the same guy, Theophilus. And he says, all these things have happened, and now Jesus is getting ready to go back to heaven, and we're going to begin to see a brand new dispensation arriving. A brand new thing that God is going to do. So I'm going to call this message this morning. The Lord gave me this title early this morning. I couldn't come up with the title. And the Lord laid it on my heart to say, call it the 40-day finale. Everybody say finale.
Finale.
How many have ever seen movies where they say this is the final of the series, you know, and I always used to think it was all over. That's the end of the series. And then a few months later, you see the same series going on, the same people going on. And I realize they do segments of it, and then they call it the finality of that series, and then they start a brand new series and a brand new series. And so I want to call this the 40-day finale. Hallelujah. This is the last day that He's on the earth after 40 days of showing forth His infallible proofs of His resurrection and all the wonderful things that happened. And then, not only that, the inspirational message that I gave last week concerning God's purposes for our life after He was going to leave. It was to feed His sheep and to take this gospel. And He continues that same same thought here in Acts chapter 1. And it was the final day of Jesus before his ascension. And he prepares his disciples and followers for that next great plan of God, the dispensation of the church age to come, which he promised he would do. He told them way back in Matthew chapter 16, he says, the day is coming that I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And at that time, they had no clue what he's talking about. And even now, I don't think they really had a clue as to what God was getting ready to do. But his final words were words of instruction and words to inspire them. And this was going to be the most dramatic day ever in the lives of the disciples. For 39 days leading up to this, I mean, they had experienced every kind of emotion from depression and suicide and fear that after he died, they were all hiding in an upper room, scared to death they were going to be the next ones to die. And Peter, I'm sure, felt like just ending it all, that God could never forgive him for denying him, and the doubts, and then the questions that came to him when they found the tomb that was empty, and they had no clue, but did they steal the body? What has happened here? They weren't thinking resurrection. They were thinking somebody is stirring up a major problem. We're going to be in a lot of trouble. Somebody stole Jesus. Yeah. And these emotions were filling their heart. These two guys on the road to Emmaus, we preached about them and how they were just so discouraged and so depressed in their life, and everything that they'd hoped for, all the dreams of everything, of walking and being with Jesus, all those 3.5 years have just been just devastated by what had happened. And the emotions were filling their heart as they walked on that Emmaus road. Only our hearts can't even imagine what they were going through when Jesus walked alongside them, began to share with them the scriptures. The next thing you know, he's opening their hearts, and then their hearts begin to burn within them. And I can't imagine that experience, realizing it's Jesus. He's alive. He's alive. And they ran back to tell the others, and they still didn't believe, and all that emotions, until all of a sudden you can imagine Jesus walking through that door and saying, peace be unto you. And the presence and the power that filled that upper room was going to transform them and make them into an army that was going to come forth out of that upper room and turn this world upside down. I'm talking about the finale of the 40 days of Jesus on this earth. And he set things in motion, hallelujah, that to this day are still moving in the dynamic power of God's Holy Spirit. And I want to talk about that wonderful, wonderful experience that they had, and that same experience is the experience that God has for you and me. And I see here four things that were stressed to the disciples in Acts chapter 1 that laid the foundation for how the church was going to become the powerhouse for the glory of God. And if we'll learn from what Jesus had to say in this grand finale, telling this last day, his last words, telling the power